Dr. Stone. More like Dr. Stoned. Thank you. No, thank you. I'll be here all night, folks. If you want more, go to my Twitter. God damn it, I gotta get the free trial. Use crunchyroll.com/your... No, that is a joke. Do not use that, it's not real. Dr. Stone is an anime about a sassy psychopath named Senku that lives in the jungle with his two dumber friends, him and her. How'd he get there? Well, I'm glad you asked. On a bright school day, everyone in the world just turned into stone. I don't know how else to put it.
Senku? More like, you're welcome.
I said the joke first, fight me! I have major qualms with some characters. I said it. I kinda hate literally every secondary character in the beginning. They're just so unbelievably dumb and, in general, have no real sense of what they want to do. Take for example, him. Him also goes by Taiju and spent literally thousands of years thinking about a girl who, prior to this incident, had less than 5 minutes of screen time. We have no reason to believe she's important. And we never get that chance because him and her disappear within like 2 episodes. Also, I'm pretty sure her is going to reject him. There's just no way it's going to work out.
I've waited thousands of years as a coward. I've always meant to tell you, I love you.
That's gay. Is that Tarzan? Is that Tarzan? Best anime ever. Best anime ever. 10 out of 10. Tarzan in anime. So this Tarzan-looking fella here is Tsukasa Shishio. And he wants to stop our protagonist from releasing everyone because... old people are bad? What? Like, I understand his motivations of stopping greed from happening, but where in the world did you get the idea that young people are innocent good people that are pure and haven't been tainted by greed and war? Like, there must be a logical path he's following before he takes a giant leap off of the logic meter. So young people won't do what old people did? I don't get it. Sounds like you're making an assumption there. And how exactly is he going to curate every person in the new world? He can't possibly do that. There's a lot of assumptions being made to do any of this. I know the villain is supposed to be wrong in his philosophy and do wrongful things, but this doesn't even work as a justification for those bad things. Later on, you can easily tell he's revived people to kill Senku more than reviving people because they're good people. To add, he isn't really compelling. You see, the idea of being compelling is very hard to explain because of all the nuances needed to mention, but I think a basic detour into it will be able to explain what makes something compelling. Our first few instances of seeing Tsukasa was that he likes nature. He kills a lion and says it was okay because it's the circle of life. Way to go, Simba. He then mentions how seashells are free and that the ocean doesn't belong to anyone, which is pretty clean before he mentions his new ideals, using a story where an old dude ruined something for a kid by beating him to death. And because of that, old people are tainted with greed and they own land, that they will soon revert back to their old selves and want rent for being on their land and something else. As of now, which is the first 50 chapters, he's just a guy that sees older people as capitalistic. Something that, you know, isn't related to age. It's like the creator wanted something really smart and have the main character and the antagonist disagree in philosophy, but couldn't find any reason for them to not get along. So he shoehorned this stupid ideology into the antagonist. And just as a quick reminder, Senku and Tsukasa don't even disagree or agree in philosophy. Senku is all about science and has no interest in politics, where Tsukasa does have that interest in politics. So vote for Tsukasa Shishio Tarzan. He can make America communist. On the other side, the protagonist Senku is pretty good. Despite having an IQ of 10 billion and being kind of a dick, he's authentic because of his process of logic. As soon as Tsukasa was released from the stone and killed the lion, he was already thinking about how Tsukasa was the strongest human at the current moment. He's shown many times that he loves science, and from his many trials of miracle water mixes, you can tell he's a quizzical, science-loving kid. He's got a philosophy as well. That is, science can explain everything and that it's imperative to returning humanity to what it once was. His philosophy directs the things he does and the way he feels, and the other way around later in the story. Senku's philosophy feels as if it was tailored to him specifically, making it really compelling. There are times where he uses that science to help save others, and not even in the sense of freeing them from stone. But it goes to show he's compelling because he's a consistent character. It never felt as if his character changed at any moment for the story depending on the situation. Speaking of for the story, I think Senku's intelligence is sometimes a little annoying as it seems to be a simple tool to push the story forward. The point of sharing a story, whether in real life or in fiction, is to tell someone a narrative. And as all good narratives, it needs purpose. For most anime, that's entertainment. For Dr. Stone, it's entertainment. You're not looking around examining every frame because it's not that kind of show. Because of this, stories often have a 1 in a million chance of something happening within the story at least once. And that's fair, because what is the point of a story if it's mundane and commonplace? There needs to be something that happens that typically doesn't happen for the story to be worthwhile. It's the exact reason why we don't think everyone turning into stone is stupid, or how Tsukasa is an expert in calcium carbonate for some reason. Which, duh, if you don't even know what calcium carbonate does, you might as well neck yourself. Just do it. Just do it. Just fucking do it. But if you multiply a 1 in a 1,000 chance with another 1 in a 1,000 chance, you get a 1 in a million chance of both events happening. And if you do it again and again, you get to 1 in a billionth, then 1 in a trillionth, and then 1 in a quad. I guess that at some point, I kind of feel as if I slightly abandon the story because of disbelief sometimes. So our main character, who is a scientist, is also amazing in making weapons, cement and mortar, soap? What? Literally everything, including goddamn glasses. What can this dude not create? Apparently, nothing. He can create everything, and that's my issue. I don't think at any point his lack of prior knowledge will ever become a problem. There's barely any figuring out he does, typically because he already knows exactly what to make. As seen on episode 1, science is a learning process, and as said by our main character, science is due to using rules and principles and applying diligence and effort to explain things. I don't ever feel like I see it from Senku enough, and that's the issue. It's almost as if sometimes he can push the story forward for no other reason than he's a genius. So what about the story? Well, what about the story? Oh my god. The story is pretty... alright. It's good. I don't want to mention it all that much, but I love when arcs bleed into each other. And it just makes things feel like there are no arcs. It's what makes things feel neatly placed, and feel like each part of the adventure is important. Because it should be. As soon as him and her were removed because they were probably consummating behind a bush like some goddamn Neanderthals, the story became a lot more good because it had two less retarded southern apes. I love the mention of Chrome being this primitive scientist, but not really knowing it. He calls it sorcery and is just fascinated in magic, but the inclusion of him was very fitting for Dr. Stone as a series as it kind of tells you that science is a byproduct of curiosity. And what's great is that it continues to have this undertone in science as the series progresses. And as of now, I've been loving the narrative use of science. I'm loving the sort of characters that are appearing. As soon as this arc started, everyone got some sort of characterization. Chrome, Suika, and even Asagiri Gen. And Senku even became a lot more driven because of his science cult. But with all the mixed things I've mentioned, I still think it's highly interesting. And I think it's because it does have genuine moments of hype sometimes and psychological fun. It's not thriller material, but it can definitely be good. I love the pacing for this show so much, I actually went on to read the manga, which is something I don't typically do. In fact, it's very important that I mention this, but I like the very speedy flow to the entire thing. You never feel as if they have gone too quick, and they even spend good time with characters. They dedicate a good chunk of an episode to just Suika and her eyes and how they make glasses, which makes her a lot more of a memorable character. And with those glasses, it serves as a tool to strengthen others later on. Also, it's very easy to see that many things are planned ahead, since one creation can account for many things, such as when Senku reused the pulley. It's clear to see that many things have a structural purpose to the story, and it's pretty damn glued to the plot. The only time I think the story took a detour was like the beginning where they made wine. There's nothing much else for me to talk about anymore, so yeah, if you can get past some of the infuriating parts in the beginning, you can get to some really good arcs. I'd say this is the best show airing this summer. This show so far earns a solid, decent out of masterpiece. Hey, if you enjoyed this video, leave a like and a comment. Don't forget to subscribe. Bye.